aliens.
We did a prior episode about whether it makes sense to believe they exist. But for today, let's assume that they do exist and that we want to meet some. How would we let them know we're here? Let's leave aside for the moment the fact that signaling aliens might not be a good idea. If we wanted to do it, how would we go about it? Today, I'm going to summarize three different signaling methods that have been discussed in the literature, along with their pros and cons. I make no claim that this list is comprehensive. If I've missed something major, you can let me know in the comments. But if you're going to bring up probes, which you can, you should know that I'm deliberately ignoring that option. It's too slow, it's too hard to do in bulk, and it's too reliant on aliens being able to decipher the content of the probes. I want to discuss signaling without the added complications of messaging. Let's start with radio. Contrary to popular misconception, it could be very difficult for aliens to pick up the radio and TV transmissions that we've been leaking into space since around World War II. The growing consensus is that even if nearby aliens have space-based radio receivers with a total area equivalent to a large city pointed right at Earth full-time, our leakage would be hard to detect, let alone decipher. You can see the links in the description for papers that have analyzed this. So what would it take to have a radio beacon that operated fairly continuously and could be detected? Well, a 2010 paper linked below by Benford, Benford, and Benford, it's three physicists all related, analyzed the physics and the economics of this question. Now, I'm simplifying a bit here, but they suggest that the optimal solution would be a phased array of many radio telescopes sending narrow pulses of high-powered microwaves at frequencies of 10 gigahertz or higher, sweeping the whole sky about once a year or so. Now, depending on the available and affordable transmission power, and we're talking gigawatts here minimum, an array like this could be detected from a few thousand light years away. But the cost would be enormous, $100 billion just to get an omnidirectional transmitter built, or only about $10 billion if you aimed it in the galactic plane alone, where for reasons I can't get into here, many people think life is more likely. Now, ongoing costs for operation, personnel, and power would add billions more dollars. So while large distances with microwave transmission are possible, it would require a massive ongoing investment of humanity's resources to go loud enough and last long enough to go beyond a mere cosmic blip. So let's move on to method two, lasers. Nowadays, lasers can produce high-power, ultra-short pulses that can outshine the sun for less than a nanosecond. Nothing natural pulses with stellar brightness for a nanosecond at a time, so laser pulses would look distinctly artificial to our Vulcan friends. They're also detectable. Even we can notice pulses that short with photomultiplier tubes, although you need repeated flashes to know that you don't have a false positive from a cosmic ray or something. Attenuation from interstellar dust makes the range for optical lasers less than that for microwave beacons. You only get about 1,000 light years or so before it becomes too dim. But at those distances, a laser spot size would only grow to around the size of Jupiter's orbit. So you could target the pulse to individual star systems and avoid wasteful transmission into empty space. With a lot of lasers, you could even flash several star systems per second, re-aim and repeat over and over. Now, we could probably implement this in a few decades, but as with radio, the continuous energy usage would be very expensive, and that is the major overhead of the options we've discussed so far. You have to keep transmitting for a very long time to increase the odds that someone will see the signal, or there's not much point. But there's another signaling option that wouldn't require us to transmit anything at all. In a recent video, we discussed the transit method for finding exoplanets. Using something like NASA's Kepler satellite, astronomers stare at 150,000 or so stars at once, continually for a few years, looking for the tiny dips in starlight that occur when a planet transits in front of its host star along our line of sight. This is actually how the majority of exoplanets have been identified. Now, if Kerbals are doing astronomy, and that's our target audience, they're probably also looking for planets, and they're probably using, among other things, a device like Kepler to do it. Why? Because even though there are other ways to detect exoplanets, the transit method is the only one that scales well. With a few Kerbal Keplers, the Kerbal astronomers could look at hundreds of thousands or millions of stars at once. All right, here's where it gets interesting. What if instead of a planet, the object that's transiting in front of its star looks like this? Or like this? Before Kepler was even launched, French astronomer Luc Arnold wrote a paper, linked below, showing that the transits of objects like these could be distinguished from those of round planets. And a sequence of louvered slits would look especially distinct and artificial, all without any transmissions or energy requirements. Now, these objects wouldn't need to be the same mass as a planet, but they would need to be the same size. So I'm picturing an ultra-thin, ultra-lightweight, opaque material that we could launch into solar orbit and then unroll like a sail. That's not doable today, but in a few hundred years, maybe. Now, we would need to tweak the orbit occasionally due to solar wind and radiation pressure, but if that could be automated, or if space maintenance missions inside the solar system become easier for us in the future, then this setup could serve as a really long-lasting billboard. Now, like the lasers, billboard transits could only be seen within a few hundred light years of Earth, or maybe a couple of thousand if the Kerbal Kepler instrument is really sensitive. So to signal aliens very far away near the galactic center, you'd still need high-powered microwaves. But all in all, a billboard seems like a distinct, cheap, ongoing signal that aliens could notice just by doing exoplanet astronomy, even if they aren't looking for other aliens. I want to finish with a comment. Suppose we conclude that billboards are the most efficient, most noticeable way to signal aliens, or at least one of them. Then aliens might apply Princess Bride poison logic. They might think that we'd think that they'd think that billboards are a good signal so that we would go looking for them, in which case, in order to catch our attention, maybe aliens have put up billboards. To my knowledge, no one has actually analyzed exoplanet transit data to look for these signals. But the Kepler dataset is public. We put a link in the description. Everyone has access, including SETI. So, besides looking for radio signals and laser pulses, which SETI does now, should SETI also be looking for geometric alien billboards orbiting nearby stars? Let us know what you guys think in the comments. As always, I'll report back on the conversation on the next episode of Space Time. 2 weeks ago, we asked whether gravity was an illusion. We followed it up last week with a challenge about a helium balloon in freefall. I'm gonna answer comments from the gravity episode first, then give you the answer to the challenge question. First off, BlackMark52 and Gary Oak both pointed out that the frames of reference video that we linked to is from University of Toronto and not MIT. I knew that, it was a brain hiccup. We'll put up a correction. My apologies to all of Canada. Several of you asked whether Earth is actually expanding outward, and that's not what I meant at all. What I meant to get across is that since Earth's surface obviously is not accelerating outward in the ordinary sense of the word, then we wouldn't be able to call a falling frame inertial and Earth's surface accelerated unless we re-examine what we even mean in the first place, or think we mean, by the terms acceleration and inertial frame. That means re-examining Newton's first and second laws and so forth. Something is going to have to give. Now, in the last episode, I was just trying to give the gist of Einstein's early thinking about gravity, which evolved, and to give you a general flavor of the seeming tension between the equivalence principle and common sense that can only be resolved once we change our concept of the geometry of the world, including the fact that time has a geometric character. More details about this will come in a future episode. Other questions that a lot of you asked were similarly noting these points of apparent tension. For instance, Ewan Johnson, Josh Mullins, and DanX505 all asked how two frames of reference falling on opposite sides of Earth can both be inertial when they're clearly accelerating with respect to each other. And Agent Quadruple Zero pointed out that you can distinguish ordinary acceleration from real Newtonian gravity because real gravity will vary in strength slightly at both ends of a falling box. Now, these are exactly the right things to point out, but the last episode wasn't intended to address them. All these tensions end up being resolved by, among other things, the facts that, one, acceleration does not mean what you think it means, and two, once we get the meaning of acceleration clearer, the rule that inertial frames at different locations can't be accelerated with respect to each other breaks down. Look, I know it's frustrating when I say that we'll get there, and I know that the answers I'm giving at this stage aren't satisfying or even really answers, and that's somewhat unavoidable. I'm trying to take material that is inherently mathematical and that it takes most professionals years to understand and make it sensible to non-professionals without using any math. That's really difficult. I don't want to end up just throwing out buzzwords that aren't fully explained or recycling analogies that at some level are a little misleading. So to do justice to the concepts, I need to break them down into smaller chunks and build on one another. And remember, each of these smaller chunks is still super weird. So I know what you're looking for and I'm trying to do a good job for you. Just bear with me, we'll get there soon. Lexis Lex asked whether all frames are inertial in GR, or even if the concept of inertial frame is even coherent in general relativity. And that is a great question that we'll also be discussing in upcoming episodes. But here's a short answer. Inertial frames exist in GR. They're just freely falling frames. But global inertial frames do not. You can't describe all events everywhere with a single inertial frame, only ones that are relatively close to the origin of your frame in both space and time. Finally, Pedro Guzmán, Stefan W., and Jordan Pamantes all noted for different reasons that maybe illusion isn't the best word to use when describing gravity. I don't disagree. I also don't expect people to take our titles and our phrasing ultra literally, which I think most viewers understand, but we still need some kind of concise phrase that's not terribly misleading, and illusion is close enough. This is also why I air quote things so much. And now the moment you've all been waiting for, the answer to the challenge question. If I take a van that has a balloon in it filled with helium that's attached to the floor by a string, and I simultaneously drop the van off a cliff and cut the string, relative to the interior of the van, the balloon does not move. There are several ways to understand why that's the answer. I think the easiest is to invoke the equivalence principle. The frame of the falling van should be equivalent to a frame that's in intergalactic space away from gravity. Now, if you put a helium balloon, even in a, you know, van filled with air in intergalactic space, how would it know which way to go? All directions are equivalent in the absence of or some kind of real gravity, you know, in the Newtonian sense, picking out some direction. So the balloon couldn't possibly go anywhere because there's no direction that's picked out. Now, how do you reconcile this with the fact that helium is still less dense than air? Shouldn't it have to float in some direction? Yeah, but buoyancy only exists in the presence of a supposed gravitational field. Fluids get less dense as they move again, you know, as you rise again in the opposite direction of a gravitational field, because the fluid that's lower down has to hold up the weight of all the fluid that's above it. Once you make everything weightless by letting it free fall or alternately going out to intergalactic space, the air below doesn't have to hold the air above anymore. There isn't even a distinction between below and above. So all the air pressure equalizes and the balloon doesn't go anywhere. Now, technically, it will take a few milliseconds for the pressure to equalize, during which there will be some slight bobbing of the balloon, but it basically stays where it is. Now, if the explanation that I just gave is not entirely satisfying to you, now that we've given the answer, I encourage you guys to start talking amongst yourselves in the comments. We got hundreds of submitted responses. Somewhere between a quarter and a third of them were right. If you see your name scrolling down below, you were one of the people who got it right with the correct answer and were among our 5 randomly selected winners. Congratulations. If you see your name, send us an email, pbsspacetime@gmail.com, with your full name, your mailing address, it can be outside the US, and your preferred t-shirt size, and we will send you your prize. Again, congratulations, and I hope the rest of you participate in future challenges.